adding a link to an image, right? So we can do image src equals get.jpg, and we do slash a. So what we did here is, in here, we specify, show us an image, please, and then around the image, we say everything between these brackets is going to be linked. So then you can have an image that you can click on, and then it'll take you to this link. And we can keep putting other stuff in here as well, right? We can put, like, more text, and yet more text, right? And when we do that, everything before the slash A is going to be included in the link, right? So I'll show you what that looks like. It's not going to show a picture, but... So it shows a broken picture and...
GitHub.com slash MK30.
Okay, okay. GitHub.com/MK30. This is a fun fact. If you have a GitHub account, your icon, your user icon, can be found at... github.com/yourusername.png. Magic.
Really?
Yes. Try it out. So you can see it. There it is. That's my user icon.
That's amazing.
Okay. Are we all set? Are we good to move on? Does everyone get any questions? Okay. Great. So, image and... These are all combinable, right? You can have text that's also a link that's also italicized. Then finally, a really common one is headers, which gives you big text. And H1 is the biggest, and they go all the way down to H6. And I can show you really briefly what that looks like. We're going to have a crazy, actually. We're going to have a crazy H1. H1 and then H6 dogs slash H6. And if we refresh, you can see that's what the big header looks like, and that's what the tiniest header looks like. Auto big. So tags have, and there are many more tags. You can look online for all the different tags. There's loads of them. But these are the common ones. Tags have attributes. Attributes are modifications and specifications that you can make on a specific tag. So as you can see here, we've got our friend, image source, but then within, for the closing bracket, right, while we're still in that tag, we can specify a height and a width. And these are in pixels. So these are attributes of the image element. If you would like the right vocabulary. You'll see this in the documentation, so it's good to know what the vocabulary is. And over here, you can see all of the image attributes. Let's see how many there are. And if you're looking for references online, and you're like, you know, what are all the different things that I can specify with image, right? If I'm using the image tag, how many different things can I configure about it, or additional things can I specify? You can, now you have like the language that you can use for it, attributes. So you can do, Ctrl+Shift+, you can do height, you can do align, you can give it a border, etc. So these are the attributes specifically on image. So what tags are there? Loads of tags. You can check them up at that list. Many are very rarely used. A few common ones, you know, we're presenting. Sorry, it looks bad. But you can explore more tags with view source and inspect element. So let's check out how to do that. So we look at the coolest website ever. And if you right click, nope, don't translate the page. Show original. If you right-click, there's this view page source option, and you can look and see what the HTML for any website looks like. So you can see this is what the structure looks like. HTML opens the tag. Then a head specifies some metadata. The title is the part that appears up here, right? So that's how you make it say Cyber Wizard Institute in this little tab. This is a style sheet, which we'll talk to later. And then we get to the body, which is where the stuff that actually appears, that's actually displayed. So we have an image source, we know this, that's the logo. And then we have another image. Then we have an H tag to make calendar big. We have a style for it. This is one attribute of the H tag. We have some links, and then on and on and on. So you can look at lots of different, sometimes it's hard these days in the modern era to look at fancy websites and see their HTML because they're not written like I wrote this. They're created by other scripts and things. But back in the GeoCities days, when I learned HTML, like, you could really look at a lot of websites that were created by everyday people, and that's how you learned HTML. That's how I learned HTML, by looking at the source and seeing, like, yeah, I want to have a banner on the side. Like, that would be really cool. Like, how did this, like, Pokemon website do it? Like, so, viewing source, you can learn interesting stuff. The other thing you can do is inspect element. And so each of these things, right, on this page is an element. Like, this is an element, this is an element, that's an element, that's an element. If there was any text, it's just all the stuff that's displayed. These are all elements. And if I right-click on anything, even that's not what I wanted to do, if I right-click on anything, like so, I get an inspect element option down here. And what this does is it will open this thing called the console of our browser, which we can make big. There we go. And it'll highlight where the code is that codes that element. And so you can see there is a div here, and an input, and a background, and all of it's transparent, and all this other stuff. And you can actually go around and click around to the different, not click, just mouse over these different pieces, and it'll highlight up here the different elements visually, so you can sort of like match which pieces go with what. And that can give you, even if it's kind of complicated and hard to understand, you can still see how they made it.
Which browsers already have the console built into them?
I think you can inspect element. This is Chrome. I think you can inspect element in Firefox, no?
There's something called Firebug people use. I don't know if that's specifically for HTML CSS or just JavaScript. Can you repeat that?
I think Chrome, Firefox, I don't know, does Safari have it? I think so, yeah. If you have trouble finding it on Firefox, there's a thing called Firebug, which gives you the console as well. Okie dokie. So I'm just going to sort of speed through a few common tags that you might want to structure your page. The first one is div, and it creates a box for the text that goes all the way across the screen. So we can and then you can specify like what you want with attributes and styles, the things that you want the div to look like. Do you want it to have a border? Do you want it to have a background? And then it'll have a box for the text across the screen. This is how you can separate your text out into blocks. Span is a section of a single line. So it's useful if you want to sort of create a unique style, like a different color font for text within a div. So say you have a big long line of black, and then you want to make a red, you can have a span, a section of red. Is this visible? Table. Table creates just a grid. And the way that it works is you say, goes first by rows and then by columns. So you say here you can see a row, and within that row are two columns. And the text you want to appear in each column goes here and here. Here's another row, right? This is the row TR, and this is two columns within that row. And you can also style each of these individually, so you can have like each box have a different background color if you want. Is this clear? And there's also the header for a table, which allows you to put like a title across the top of your table. What is the tag for that?
TH.
TH. And you can put that at the beginning. Sorry, didn't have a chance to add that in here. Bullet points. Everyone loves bullet points. UL stands for unordered list. You can also have OL, which is an ordered list, which will give you 1, 2, 3. So what this does is this says start a bullet point, bullet pointed list, and then each of these will have a bullet point in front of it. So it'll be like bullet point, text, bullet point, text, bullet point, text. Is that clear? I see confusion.
Do a demo.
Wow. Put me on the spot, man.
Hey, Marina. Quick question. How do you find the file path of the file that you're about to put into the browser?
Okay.
Via command line. Did you want to talk about that?
Sure, I can talk about
that. You can just type pwd, that'll show you your current directory.
Right.
And if you go to file colon slash slash and you paste that path, the browser will open a directory listing of that, and you can click on the file.
That's a really good point. So you see how I have the GitHub URL. If you want to use local files, like on your own machine, or you have to give it the exact path if it's not in the same directory, right? So you know how sometimes you'll try to, in the command line, open a file, and it doesn't work because you're not in the right directory, and you haven't given it the whole path. So it works exactly the same way here. So if you do image source equals cat dot png, if cat.png isn't in the same directory as your HTML file, it won't work. And otherwise, you can specify slash temp slash cat.png.
Or a relative path that doesn't start with like forward slash.
Or
is much more common.
Like that.
Well, if it were a directory called kp in the current directory.
Yeah.
Like images slash, for example.
All clear?
One question about that.
Yep.
Only goes down, can't go up. Does that make sense? That you can't go up in a directory and access something? It just needs to go down.
You can.
With
you
dot dot slash, just like on the command line.
Okay. Dot dot slash.
Yep. And you can have dot dot slash, dot dot slash, dot dot slash, as many as you need to go up.
Okay. Thank you.
And in order to do, you would do dot slash, right?
No, okay. You don't need to do that. Because dot slash just means the current directory.
Okay. Very good. Confusing the codes. Bullet points? Oh, I was going to do a live demo.
Yeah, do a demo.
Points. Okay. List. I find it really helpful when writing HTML and other things to put your opening and closing brackets so you don't lose them. You don't forget to close something. So I make the opener and the closer down there, and then I make a little room for myself, and then I can put things inside. So one tab, bullet point, fish, algae. Here, there's our ordered list, unordered list, all the way at the bottom. You can put other stuff in there if you want. You can make a list of links, whatever you want. You can have a form. say, and perhaps some of you who did the application for Cyber Wizard Institute, remember, you had to enter text into a form. You can do that with HTML. And the way it works is with a tag called form. This information specifies what to do with the form, which we will cover a little bit more in depth later. And then this says, P is a paragraph tag. This will show cats, question mark. And then here you can say, you have to give it an input type. Like, what do you want the type of thing for people to enter into the form? Text. So you can also have things like a box of text, you can have a radio button, different kinds of things. And then it'll know, based on this input type, what kind of box or other interactive element to show you. And you give a name to that one so that you can access it later, right? So it's like, you can even call them box one, box two, box three, but you can call them like name, phone number, address, whatever you want. In this case, I'm calling it cats because that is related to the question I'm getting. And it'll get stored with the name, right? It'll say like cats and then your response. And then at the bottom, usually, you have to have an input type submit, which is a submit button or other way for someone to like actually complete the form. And the value that you give it is submit, whatever you want. All good? Yes?
Then you can use style to format that to different sizes.
Yep. You can style this as much as you want. It doesn't have to be a plain text form. So now we're going to talk a little bit about, we've covered the basics of HTML a little bit. You can view the source of certain things to get like a template for what you want to do, which is how I made my famed websites when I was 15. And so now there's this other thing that often goes with HTML called CSS, and that stands for Cascading Style Sheets. I always thought of it like a waterfall. So you can modify how your elements appear by giving them different styles. So if we remember attributes, right? So we have an element like a tag and then an attribute like the width, right? There are some elements have attributes that are really specific to them, like the image one has height and width, and maybe some other ones won't have height and width. But there are also global attributes that every element, every type of tag you can use in HTML, you can use these attributes on. And a few that we're just going to talk about really briefly are style, class, and ID. And you can see all the global attributes down at that URL. Is there more stuff there? No. Okay. The style attribute lets you specify lots of different kinds of things about the way that the stuff in the tag is going to appear on the page, right? So the very basic format is it goes in here between your opening, your brackets where you start the declaration for what should come after. And first, so we have the H1 tag, we remember what that is. This could be, you know, font, it could be whatever else you want. And then it's style equals, and then there's another statement in there, right? Separated off by these what are they called? Quote marks. And here you specify what the thing is that you want to style and what you want it to be, right? So it's like, I want to set the color to blue. You might want to say, I want to set the font to Arial. So the basic structure is the thing I want to do something to and what I want it to be. And all of that has to be in here with style specified. Right? You can't just put color blue. You have to say, now I'm going to do a style and I want that style to be color blue. Then this will apply to everything in here. Okay. But there's more. You can specify many styles in once, right? You don't have to keep going style equals color blue, style equals color like font Arial, style equals whatever. You can separate multiple styles with a semicolon, but all within this bracketed up statement, everything between these is going to be my style. There I have multiple sets of things separated out, like multiple two statements that go together. Does that make sense? Separated by semicolon. So this is what's called inline styles. So you're specifying it as you're going through your HTML and saying only to this exact H1 statement are we going to apply this style. You might have other H1s on your page, but this style will only apply to what goes in here. So, inline, using a style attribute, style attribute related to an element. Internal, using a style element in the HTML head section. So what that means is, if we, let's go back to our source. So that would be, remember the head that specifies the metadata? We can specify lots of different kinds of style information up here, and then it'll apply to those things below here in the actual body. It'll apply to the whole document. And then the third part is external, using one or more external CSS files. And so I can show you what that looks like here. So this is the external CSS file, and how you specify it is like this. In the head, link rel equals style sheet, href, which is the link to where it lives, and it lives at style.css, which is a separate file. Right? You can just create a file in a text editor, call it style.css, and this is what it looks like. So here, a bunch of stuff. So, and this gets to how you will often see, I have an example in here, but I think we should just look here at how it's most often displayed. So we had it all in one line, right? We had like style equals, and then quote marks, I keep forgetting that word, and then we separated off the different pairs of styles by semicolons. So you can see a really similar pattern, but a little bit different here in the CSS document itself. This is also the same format that you would use if you're specifying styles in the head. So instead of equals, we have these two brackets, the opening bracket and the closing bracket. And so what this part says is, this is style for every element that's H1, right? So the first example we did, we applied H1 only to that specific instance of H1, what appeared between those tags right there. But this will apply it to every instance of H1 on the page, okay? And we're specifying open brackets and closing brackets, and again, this is the pair of things, where we say this is the thing that we want to modify and this is what we want to set it to. And those are set separated by semicolons. Are we on the same page? Kind of? Okay. And so a few things about this. The first is that you need those semicolons. The second is that there are default styles for all of the different elements. And they will get loaded automatically. You don't have to put all the default styles in. The only reason why you would need a style.css is to modify certain pieces of it, right? And so, like, here we specify width and background color and margin and padding, but we don't specify that in other areas because I'm okay with the default. So these are just additive, right? Or to change something from the default. But you don't have to have a style sheet at all, right? And you don't have to style all of the elements. They'll just appear the way they are. And where were we at? So, styles per element. We can style how the H1 looks. We can style how, you know, a refs look. We can style how headers look. Well, that's a header.
Could you make a new style and just give it a name?
Yes.
And then later somehow put that on something?
Yes, I will get to that a little bit later. Okay. these things called IDs. You use an ID when there's only a single element that you want to modify ahead of time. So,
getting garbled,
yeah. So, here's the example is, we remember the div, right? Div specifies a section, a box of text across the entire screen. And then we just put some text in there. But we can give that div a special ID, which is completely unique. It has to be unique within the file. Can it start with numbers? Is there anything weird about numbers and IDs?
No.
Not if that's just the name of the ID.
Okay. So you give it a unique ID, and that way you don't have to go looking for this particular instance to do the inline style. You can go up and have specify it at the top. Say everything with this ID should have this particular style. You know where to look. You don't have to go looking for it inline to find where to change it. You had a question. Good. Does this make sense? That you would specify in the top portion of the stack. So the next thing you could do, so now we know how to do styles at the top or in an external sheet for elements, right, which is all instances of a particular thing, like h, for a single instance of a particular thing, like a single h1, and we have two ways to do that. And so now we're going to talk about styles for a particular class. So a class is when you want to put things that are different elements into one category and style that category, give that entire category of thing or grouping of thing a particular style. So we can have, this in this example, we have a whole bunch of divs, right? So we have like different sections of text on the screen, and we've given each of those divs a class, and that class title is cool. Alright, what's the deal with cool? What is the deal with cool? I think this is supposed to say cool.
Oh, yeah.
This is a typo. So it's hash?
No, it's dot.
Dot. Okay. So this, imagine this as cool. So when you put a dot in front of it, this specifies that we're now talking about a class. We're now going to define styles for a class. And then we can say what we want everything with that gets that class to be the style that we want it to have. So in this case, if we have every div or any other element that we give the class cool, we'll get these style attributes. But we can have divs that don't have the class cool, and then we can style them differently or have them be completely separate, have their default. Yes, sir?
What is the big difference between IDs and class, then?
Well, an ID only specifies a single instance. It's unique. So you couldn't, I don't believe that you could use an ID for all three of these.
Okay.
The same ID. So it's like if you wanted if you want multiple divs to have the same style, then you've got to use class. But if you want to say, no, I know the third div, you know, it's going to be at the bottom. I want it to look a little bit different. You can give it an ID. But you can also give it a class and an ID, which we're going to get to next. External style sheets, we looked at that. View the source, just an example for you guys for later. So, CSS selector. So this is exactly what that question was referring to. You can create blocks of CSS rules that apply to more than just classes and IDs with this thing called CSS selectors. So you can specify a row and a dot title and give them both the same style, right? You can specify multiple things. So you can say, I want the H1s and the H2s to have color cyan, for example. Sorry, this isn't showing up correctly. So what this this will match the class title. Actually, yeah. Does this make sense?
Not to be confused with the command file.
So you can define several classes at once to be all the same?
Yes.
Okay. No.
No.
No. What that does is it gives a path to the title, right? So that rule up there, hash page, dot row, dot title, what that specifies is a path into your HTML.
Oh, I see.
So it goes to page first, and then
row.
It goes into class. And then because we're using spaces and not greater than signs, it actually can skip over header and into title, and that matches.
Oh, so it's for like a hierarchical nesting.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Apologies. So if you want to get access to a particular element within other elements, but only this one, right? This won't match on the date.
Yeah. Or if you had a title that was not beneath a row and page, that also would not match that rule.
Spaces between the elements to specify the path that they should go down. But there's also lots of other things you can do. So match an element by its tag name in between. Is this a capital E? Yeah. Yeah. Lots and lots of different things to do. Including, you know, take a particular element and only match the ones that have a subclass, right, of X of that element.
And if you don't specify the element, it defaults to any element. So that's why how we're doing dot cool or like hash XYZ or something, that's why that matched. Because it's the same to do star dot whatever.
And you can use CSS selectors directly from JavaScript. JavaScript goes within the script tag to do other things with your HTML pages. So we can use this thing called document.querySelector to pick out specific elements in the HTML that we can modify with JavaScript, and or create, right, or whatever. And so we can use neat and message when we already have neat and message up here as ID and class, and then make additional modifications to it with JavaScript. So that's like you grab a hold of, this says, all right, we're going to have a script. Now we're going to do the script browser, all right? Let's grab a hold of some stuff on the page. That's what document.querySelector says, in order for us to make changes to it. Then you can say, well, what do we want to grab a hold of? We want to grab a hold of everything that's neat followed by message. And then within that, we can do other things. Give it additional text content, which will put the content into here. Crazy, right? So you can add additional text with JavaScript into your HTML. Questions? Any questions? We're good? Yes.
Are those single quotes or double quotes within query selector?
Single.
It doesn't matter.
But these are single. And we're going to have a lot more about working with the these kinds of things a little bit later. You had a question, Scott? Fun fact, you can find all of these lecture notes in the workshops repo on GitHub. This is under HTML. Okay, now, fun part. You can host your HTML on this really great website called NeoCities. I was mentioning mentioning GeoCities earlier. For those who aren't familiar, this was a glorious thing in the 90s that let anybody have a small amount of their own personal HTML space on the internet for free. It was wonderful. And it let you just, like, you can upload HTML files. All right, here you go. Here's your HTML file. Go wild. And so this, it got bought by Yahoo and shut down. Although it lives on in a torrent file. I'm just gonna let you guys know this. That's 1 terabyte. You can get the entire, all of GeoCities, all of it, in 1 terabyte. There's a group of folks who are into maintaining the torrent, so it stays alive, so you can always get it. And they have a blog called 1TB of the KBH, I think. 1 terabyte of the kilobyte age.
And you have to take the whole terabyte. You can't.
I don't know. Well, there, we can talk about it. I don't know why it's doing music, but anyway, this is, they chronicle their adventures in the GeoCities torrent and, like, pull up excellent things like this and talk about common elements. This is appears to be all about welcome screens. Anyway, it's pretty rad. But their site, NeoCities, has been resurrected, sort of the concept of, like, get your own little plot of the internet and, like, go wild with it, like, learn HTML, etc. They're going to editorialize, you know, with websites like, you know, Facebook, other social media sites. Like, you don't have to create, like, a My Personal webpage, right? Like, they do everything for you. And if you want to have some content that you want to add to the internet, say you like took a bunch of photos, there's lots of different ways that you could do that. Like you can put them on Instagram, Facebook, Flickr, whatever you want. But back in the old days, like none of that existed. And if you wanted other people to see your photographs, you had to upload them to your own website. And things like GeoCities let people do it for free. And by letting people, you know, even something like Tumblr, you don't have to know any HTML to do Tumblr, their free blogging sites. But if you wanted to like write things about your life, you had to figure out how to write some HTML. And because there were lots of other websites like that, lots of people, I get this view source thing. Like, I can do this view source thing. And it sort of helped get a lot of folks familiar with HTML who wanted to share something with the world, whether it was their love of American flag gifts or pictures of Beanie Babies or whatever it was, got people into code. And so, but we're going to use it to have a very low threshold barrier to entry way to do HTML. So you can go to neocities.org to make an account. This is my account, and this is what it looks like when we create a neocities.org account. And you can see they give you an index.html. What is index.html? Why do I keep seeing index.html? Index.html is typically when you go to the root of a website, like we go to nytimes.com, it will actually load index.html. for you when you go to the root. And that's something that you can specify in how your site works. And if you don't specify that, maybe it'll just show a directory. Maybe it won't show anything. Who knows what will happen. But index.html is like the home page. And here they give you some information that is in their default home page. And it's got all this stuff. It's got title. It's got an H1, welcome to my website. It's got some P's. It's got some href, right, that you can see. Oh, I'm gonna make it bigger, sorry. So yeah, it's got some ahrefs, some more P's, and then the end of the body, right, slash body, and then slash HTML. Everything is within other things. But I don't like their default, so I am going to go back and upload the HTML file that I made right now instead. hit the upload button, and it was in our temp folder. Here's cat.html, uploading, great. And then, let's see, we're going to rename this to be index. I'm just going to copy this text into index.html. And you can even edit it on the website once you upload it. If you're like, my brain hurts from trying to do Vim, you can do that instead. Okay, paste that in. Save. My file has been saved. Now when I go to cities.neocities.org, yay, there it is. So, you can, you know, if you want to play it safe, you can check in your own browser, your local HTML file, okay, what it will look like, and then when you're ready to share it with the world, can upload that file to NeoCities and have it display. And you can create directories in it, you can add more pages, you can link between pages on your NeoCities, and really play around with it and try out different things. And it would be really cool if you wanted to like create a personal page, talk about what you're interested in, we can add that to our GitHub issues, you know, flower. But if you're looking for a fun way to play with HTML and CSS and sort of like try out the ropes and get a website, I think that's a great way to do it. Any questions? That's all I have. Any questions? Yes?
Can you go over the row and title thing again with selecting on CSS? Because I've never actually done that before. I've just always, you know, linked a class or something and done that. I've never tried it that way.
James, would you mind coming up? Maybe you can explain it better.
Okay. What are you confused about? Oh, I'm just, I don't know, I just want to, like, see it in work, I guess, because, like, I see you have, like, sorry, I'm, like, drawing blanks right now. But I see, like, row title, and then I see, you have, like, not a class, but I'm an ID, a page, and then you do row and title. Is that, so you would just put row, like, 37 or something, and then... I don't know, I'm just confused. I don't understand
that. So what this means is that the ultimate thing that you'd be applying color cyan to is title. It's the last one.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the div that matches title. But title has to live inside row, anywhere inside. It doesn't have to directly be a tab. So it's fine the way it is.
Oh, no, never mind. I see what's going on.
Row
yeah.
has to live inside page.
Never mind, I got confused.
Yeah.
I actually thought you guys were doing something else. Yeah, no, I see what's going on, sorry.
And isn't it all descendants, not just one of those?
Yeah,
yes.
So if
we had more
yeah.
divs with title, it
mm.
would apply cyan to those as well.
Yeah, or if we had more rows on the page.
That's true. If we had another row with another title within it, it would also apply to that.
And they don't have to be divs, actually.
No, they don't
they,
have to be.
They just have to have the class title and the outside of something like a class row.
But you can change it however you want, right? You can say everything inside the class row, and then we can even have a div with a different ID, right? And so we can specify everything inside the class row, everything with the ID XYZ, and then style that cyan. So mix
yeah.
and match.
If you wanted to only apply these rules to divs, you would do like div.title, for example, and that wouldn't match a span with the class of title.
So you can look at it. This is what I like to do, one more thing. I like to go to websites that I think are pretty and look at their style sheets. So, whoops, got the wrong thing. So, JS.com. I think this is a really lovely website. I really liked its color scheme. And I liked how it looked. It was the sort of like inspiration for the Cyber Wizard site. and also a cool project. And I like this, where it had, like, you know, a picture on the left and then stuff on the right with a heading, and then, you know, then stuff on the left and then the picture on the right, and then et cetera, et cetera. Like, I just really like the format and style of this site, so you can take a look at page source. And where is their style sheet? Multiple style sheets. Let's just look at that one. And so you can see how they specify things. Wow, this is such style sheet. So much style sheet. Wow, look at this bounce animation. That's in CSS? Who knew? The cube? Oh, look at all these allies. List. List, list, list. Article ID. You can see these. ID, class, text. You can see some of this stuff at work. Any other questions? Okay, thank you.